session. Please proceed.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Ninth Circuit. Judge Miller and I want to welcome and thank Judge Ezra, who I think has been in trial recently, if I remember correctly. So we appreciate you taking the time out to take this argument. And I hope, I know we had some severe weather issues, let's just say, when we were going to do this argument previously. And so I hope everyone's a little wetter. We're getting hammered here in California right now with rain.
Oh yeah.
You know, it's pretty bad. But I see both counsel here. Ms. Baird, I believe you're up first. Is that correct?
Yes, Judge Owens. Thank you very much. And thank you, the court, for its consideration with the hurricane last time. I appreciate it.
Yeah, well, we have earthquakes out here and fires. You have hurricanes. I'm not sure which is worse.
I hope the rains will be okay.
Ms. Baird, you may proceed when you are ready.
Thank you. May it please the court, Lisa Baird, pro bono counsel for petitioner Bakhram Azizov. I'd like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal.
Sure.
The two key issues in this case are a nexus issue for asylum and withholding of removal, and for Mr. Azizov, Convention Against Torture or CAT claim, whether there was a particularized risk of harm and involvement or acquiescence of a government official. For both of these issues, the foundational problem is the IJ misstated and ignored crucial pieces of evidence, and those errors were adopted and affirmed by the BIA. Taking the record as a whole, the evidence compels the conclusion that Mr. Azizov was targeted because he was a Uyghur and because he expressed political opposition to the Salim Bekov clan and the MBEC political party. Turning to the nexus issue, as this court well knows, for asylum, the applicant must establish that a protected ground like race or political opinion was or will be at least one central reason for persecution of the applicant. And for withholding, there must be a clear probability that a protected ground is at least a reason for the persecution. And Mr. Azizov did that. Notably, an applicant may be persecuted for mixed reasons for both protected and non-protected grounds and still qualify for relief. Authorities like Barajas Romero and Parasumova, if I said that correctly, tell us that even for asylum, which has a somewhat stricter nexus test, the protected ground doesn't need to be the only central reason or even the most important reason. And in this case, the whole reason Mr. Azizov was targeted for having his business stolen was because he was a Uyghur with less rights than ethnic Kyrgyz citizens. And the precipitating incident was his opposition to the Salim Bekov clan's demand for political support.
So, Ms. Baird, let me jump in here because there's a sentence in the BIA's decision. It's on page 2 of the BIA's decision. I think it's on page 4 of the record.
Yeah.
It's in the middle. It's in the second full paragraph, and the sentence reads as follows when you're ready.
Yes.
It says, the respondent did not demonstrate any motive or underlying cause for any of the alleged harm or threats that did not arise from the legal matters, i.e. a personal dispute related to his marketplace rental. Now, I guarantee you when opposing counsel stands up, they're going to point to this sentence.
Right.
Tell me first, what is the standard of review for us on this sentence? And second, why is the United States wrong about why this sentence doesn't end the case?
I think for this sentence, the standard is substantial evidence because it's a finding of fact. But the problem is that, you know, the IJ and then the BIA ignored and misstated evidence. And what they did was they said he was speculating as to the motives. But in fact, the evidence showed his testimony, his 3 declarations, and there are exhibits in the record, including statements from other people in the market, saying while they were taking his stuff, it was because he was a Uyghur who stood up politically. So it's direct testimony or, you know, direct evidence as to the motive of the persecutors. And those persecutors included a lieutenant colonel of the police who was acting as sort of an enforcer for Erkin Salimbekov. And later on, police officials were directly involved in the beating that occurred in 2017 near the border with Kazakhstan. And again, while the beatings are occurring, Mr. Azizov's testimony, corroborated by his colleague who was with him at the time, and his statement in the record, was that they were telling him he was being beaten because he was a Uyghur, and because he stood up, he was a Uyghur who dared stand up politically to the Salimbekovs. So I don't get how the immigration judge and the BIA concluded it was just speculation. That is direct evidence of their motive. I hope that answers your question, no, Judge Owens.
It does, and I had a follow-up question. Is that in this case, we have the BIA's decision, which to me seems like it relies in part on the IJ's decision. Would you agree with that?
I would agree that it was hard to tell what was going on. And they said that they adopted and affirmed this, and then they cited Bourbonno. So I think it is appropriate to look to both, you know, and I would say that the BIA, you know, made the same errors again that the IJ did.
Ms. Baird, if I may, quickly, what I found a little bit puzzling is that the IJ seemed to indicate that your client was credible, didn't have any issues with his credibility, and yet also seemed to either ignore or discount in a way that didn't find its presence in her decision, all of his various statements about how he was beaten and threatened because of his Uyghur ethnicity.
Right. And that is a point that I wanted to get to, so I'm glad you asked the question. What the judge said was that his testimony was consistent internally with the documentary evidence. And where the judge said it was it was kind of incredible, it was based on her fundamental misunderstanding or misstatement of the record evidence, is starting with the fact that she presumed that Mr. Azizov had been repaid in full. But if you look at the testimony, what he testified to was that he had leased various parts of the market, a stall, a hangar, put in refrigerator equipment. His testimony establishes he had spent over $70,000, $46,000 in refrigerator equipment, $24,000 for the lease. And she looks at testimony where Erlon, which was his supplier of meat, was able to at some point go back and get some of the money. Of course, Mr. Azizov got that weird promissory note that was never paid. And the judge misunderstood that testimony to think, to state that he had been paid in full. Thus, there was no persecution, let alone persecution on account of a protected reason. And if you take that, if you correct that fundamental misperception by the immigration judge that the BIA then adopted, all that confusion that the immigration judge had falls away. So I would say that that is the fundamental kind of mistake of fact there.
My review of the record, Ms. Baird, seems to indicate that there was $5,000 that may have been paid to somebody, but he said he didn't get any of it. And this promissory note, which appears to be somewhat illusory promissory note for some amount of money.
That's right, Your Honor. And it was Erlon, this meat supplier, who was able to go back in December of 2015 to get and got $5,000 to him and not to Mr. Azizov. And I think the other confusion may have been that the Kyrgyz currency is SOM, S-O-M. And I think the immigration judge may have heard that as sum. And so she was looking at the totals and thinking that he was talking about, you know, thousands of dollars that Erlang recovered, when in fact 75,000 Kyrgyz SOM is about 875 US dollars. So there's, you know, there, you know, I admit that the history is long, but it was incumbent on the immigration judge and the BIA to look at the evidence fairly and appreciate it and not misstate it and not ignore any material parts of it. I see my time is almost up. So if I will jump just to a concluding statement, we would ask the court to hold that there was legal error in the standards applied, that the record compelled the conclusion that he established a nexus and entitlement to CAT, and either grant the petition and remand with instructions to grant relief, or at a minimum, remand for further proceedings consistent with the court's disposition.
All right, thank you, counsel. Madam Deputy, if you could give Ms. Baird 2 minutes for rebuttal when she comes back. So you got 2 minutes on the comeback, Ms. Baird.
Thank you, Judge Owens.
All right, counsel for the Attorney General.
Good morning, Your Honors, or good afternoon in my case, and may it please the court. My name is Jessica Strokas, and I represent the United States Attorney General. This court should deny the petition for review because substantial evidence supports the agency's nexus determination and denial of CAT protection. Just to get right into nexus, the question here is really, is there evidence compelling the an alternative conclusion to what the agency found? And there's already been discussion this morning about confusion in the record and the timeline. And the timeline here is actually very important because it shows that the petitioner in this case did not suffer harms that were in any other way other than speculation or his personal belief connected to his ethnicity or to his political opinion. In the timeline, the petitioner rents a stall in a marketplace from the landlord. In September of 2015, he's summoned to the landlord's office and told to pass out ballots to support the landlord's brother in a local election. He says he's not going to do that. The landlord is mad. Petitioner continues to operate his stall. In October of 2015, so 1 month later, the landlord's brother loses the election with 0% of the vote. And then in late December 2015, so December 21st, 2015, the petitioner is called to the landlord's office and told that he is essentially being evicted from the stall because they had received a report that he had sold spoiled or poisoned meat and that someone had gotten sick.
This stroke is just a minute. Can we step back a little bit in time? My sure. Recollection of the record of the testimony of the petitioner was that at the very time that he told the landlord that he wasn't going to support his, I guess it was his brother, that the landlord went after him in a big way, threatening him, accusing him of being, essentially an ungrateful Uyghur who was living in the Kyrgyzstan and, basically we'll show you or I'll get you, Uyghur, and went after him for his Uyghur ethnicity. This was like immediately when he told him that he was not supporting his brother. It wasn't, just based upon political party. It was based on his ethnicity.
Sure, Your Honor. And the quote that I have from the record written down is that the landlord said, "You forgot about the few. How dare you talk about corruption?" and told him to get out.
Well, I think you mentioned his Uyghur ethnicity, too.
And certainly, you know, the inclusion of his ethnicity may have been, you know, a way to insult the petitioner in that moment, but no direct harm is linked to his ethnicity or his refusal to pass out these ballots. Multiple months go by and the landlord's brother loses the election with 0% of the vote to an individual that has the same ethnicity as the petitioner. And 3 months go by before anything happens. And the one thing that happens is he loses his stall. He's essentially evicted. And there's no connection in that moment to, you didn't pass out the ballots for my brother, or, you know, because you're this ethnic minority, you know, why would he rent to an ethnic minority for multiple years in the first place if there was an issue there? The connection is to there was a report that you sold spoiled meat. That's what the petitioner says.
The IJ seems to have viewed it as very important that when petitioner was evicted, he was paid, he was bought out and paid fair value for the lease. And the IJ mentions that several times. And what is the evidence of that? Because it seems to me that he got this promissory note from this third party he had no relationship to. He doesn't seem to have been able to collect on it. So it seems from the record like he did not receive anything close to fair value. So what's the basis for the IJ's statement?
So, Your Honor, he received a promissory note from a third party. I believe the name is Mandikov, that the landlord had given him and to essentially go collect from Mandikov. I believe it was for $24,000, at least according to the record. And the petitioner eventually confronts or has a meeting with Mandikov. Mandikov doesn't want to pay the promissory note. So the petitioner takes Mandikov to court, files a lawsuit against him on August 12, 2016. And eventually two different courts say, yes, you are owed this money from Mandikov. That is about the amount of money that was for the remainder of his lease of the stall. Now, the petitioner has brought up that he had equipment and whatnot in his stall that he wasn't able to access. But the record shows that he went on one occasion to try to get it back, but he had not received permission to go into the marketplace from the landlord. And so he was turned away for that reason.
But does the record show that he was actually able to collect the money from Mandikov?
The record shows that, I believe it was at a court hearing on, let me see if I can find it in my notes. At one court hearing, his attorney admitted that he had been given $5,000 and that the balance that was owed to him was $19,000. Now, the petitioner says that he didn't actually personally receive that money, that it was one of his agents that received that money. But his attorney did admit in court that not in immigration proceedings, but in court abroad that he had received $5,000. So there's some contradictory evidence there.
But still, I think the point remains that if you're owed some money and instead of getting the money, you get a promissory note from some other person for that money, and of which you're able to eventually collect, you know, about 20%. That just seems like, it seems very hard to me to understand how you can describe that as being given fair value for what you were owed. And that seems to have been a key premise of the IJ's decision. So
I think an important part is that the courts did say that he was owed that money from Mandikov. The issue here really seems to be that the petitioner is upset with the landlord, who's not Mandikov, who's Selemnikov. And even though he is able to collect, and the courts are saying to Mandikov, you have to pay him this money, that he's just not satisfied with that. And he genuinely believes that Selemnikov, Kane, Mandikov, all the potentially Border Patrol, but also potentially unknown Asian people, depending on what account of his you want to take as true, and that these two random detainees in when he was detained by the police after making many false reports, that he genuinely believes that they are harming him and that he was targeted because they had a basic motive that he was, that they didn't like his ethnicity, and that they didn't like that he didn't support Zelenikov's brother in the election, that Zelenikov's brother lost by, with 0% of the vote. But his genuine belief about the basic motive of his persecutors, of his people that harmed him, isn't the question. The question is what did those people believe? And the evidence in this case, there's just a lack of evidence showing that it was his ethnicity or that it was because of this political issue. It really shows every single time, you know, when he walked into detention, the two people didn't say, oh, here's a Uyghur, I'm going to beat him up. They said, what happened to you? Why are you here? And when he explains that he wants to sue or get Zelenikov in some kind of criminal trouble, that's when they go after him. And every time that he's harmed, after he keeps bringing up this business dispute, essentially, and he's being harmed only after he brings it up. And that's what the timeline shows here. And while his genuine belief may be that he's being targeted because of his ethnicity, while there may be ethnic insults being used, the record evidence here simply is not compelling to show that a basic motive of his persecutors was his ethnicity or was his political opinion.
But
that's dispositive of nexus.
Maybe it's because I'm principally a district judge, but what I look at when somebody comes before me is, what is the actual evidence? Because I know that's what the Court of Appeals is going to look at. What is the actual evidence? And the only evidence that we have essentially is his repeatedly saying that he was threatened again and again and again because of his Uyghur ethnicity. And the evidence on the other side is trying to extrapolate into the mind of those who were threatening him that wasn't really what they were threatening him about. They were really threatening him because of his dispute. I mean, we just can't extrapolate into somebody's mind. And the problem here is that the IJ says, well, you know, this guy's credible. You know, that's why I said it just kind of, and normally in a situation like this, where the IJ finds so much evidence on the other side, which I think might've been misstated evidence, the IJ will say, well, this person was, you know, not credible. You know, we see that all the time. But no, in this case, she says, oh, no, he's credible. But then discounts
him. Yes, I understand what you're saying, and I see them over my time, but I'd like to answer your question if the court would allow me to.
It's not for me. It's Judge Owen.
Go ahead.
Sure. First, I would mention Ming Dai. Ming Dai, the Supreme Court says credibility is not dispositive of establishing persuasiveness and legal sufficiency. That's really important in this case. So while he may be credible, while he may have these genuine beliefs, that's not enough to satisfy the standards for in this case, nexus. And the nexus inquiry is again, the Supreme Court says in Elias Zacharias that nexus is talking about the basic motive of the persecutor. So we do have to look at what reason did that individual have for harming someone. And it's not enough that the petitioner himself may believe that he was harmed because of his ethnicity or because of his political opinion or whatever reason, other reason. We need to look at the evidence to say, okay, what does the evidence show the basic motive of the persecutor was? And in this case, while the petitioner tries to link his ethnicity somehow or link this political incident somehow, the things that happen immediately before he suffers any kind of physical harm are, he says, I want to get my landlord in trouble. I want to sue him. I'm not satisfied with the court saying that I'm owed money from this other person. And at that moment, he's harmed. So I think Ming Dai and Elias Zacharias really are the two governing cases here for the nexus, the agency's nexus determination. And that substantial evidence does support that decision.
All right. Thank you very much, counsel. We'll hear now from Ms. Baird.
Thank you. I would agree with my opponent that the timeline is very important, and it shows that every time that Mr. Azizov stood up to Salim Bekov, either politically or as a Uyghur who did not know his place, he was retaliated against. And the testimony from him about what was said to him as that retaliation was taking place is direct evidence of that motive, including things like the lieutenant colonel who talked about the tainted meat, which was a fiction, an excuse, said, what will happen to you and all the Uyghurs if we tell them that a Uyghur has poisoned the Kyrgyz? So, you know, it's I concur with Judge Ezra that all that is in the evidence and in the record. And with regard to the whether he was paid or not, the counsel pointed to the court records in Kyrgyzstan, and I would point the court to AR-558, which was the notice from the police captain refusing to execute on the judgment against that promissory note. So there was no payment in full, certainly. I would also say that the fact that Oscar Salim Bekov got 0% of the vote actually increases the chances of the interest in retaliating against Mr. Azizov for not supporting him. And then just for a moment, I'd like to talk about the political errors. The judge said that Mr. Azizov testified he wasn't part of a member of a political party. That is not the standard. The statute says political opinion. The nexus for withholding, the standard applied there was wrong. And then on CAT, the BIA's decision says he will be, my time is up.
No, finish your point.
Okay. The BIA's standard for CAT was that he will be harmed instead of more likely than not, and by the Kyrg government writ large instead of a government official. So there are as well legal errors that infect the BIA's decision and the IJ's decision that it adopted.
All right. Thank you very much, counsel. Thank you both for your briefing and your argument. Back when Judge Miller and I were law clerks at the Supreme Court, Chief Justice Rehnquist would actually cut off people mid-sentence. We're a little kinder and gentler when it comes. We do let you finish. With that, this matter is submitted, and this kind of mini panel for the day is adjourned. Thank you, everybody.
The court for this session stands adjourned. Thank you.